Okay, so I'm gonna switch to Spanish just to give the introduction. Pues una bienvenida a todas y todos, obviamente, a esta edición de la Cátedra Kerry, que tuvimos obviamente que mover en línea, pero pues un agradecimiento muy grande a Daniela Puzzello que aceptó de todo modo, aun si no pudimos obviamente traerla, que hubiese sido un honor más grande, pero pues así estamos con la pandemia. La Cátedra Kerry, todos la conocen, es el evento principal que organiza el CID. Se hace desde el 2012 y hemos tenido personas muy importantes que han participado a lo largo de estos años: Deirdre McCloskey, Ari Rubinstein, Jayati Ghosh, Anwar Shaikh, etcétera, etcétera, etcétera. Daniela Puzzello es profesora de la Universidad de Indiana en Bloomington, es economista de la Universidad Bocconi en Milán, tiene una maestría en economía en McMaster, una en matemática en Purdue y un PhD en economía de Purdue. Su investigación se enfoca básicamente en el estudio de las normas e instituciones de intercambio, integrando teoría y experimentos. Muchos de sus trabajos muestran cómo en presencia de fricciones o mercados incompletos, la moneda juega un papel fundamental. El ejemplo, su paper más citado en Journal of Monetary Economics o su modelo de equilibrio con contagios en econométrica. En otros trabajos ha comparado los resultados del sistema de intercambio con y sin moneda en el lab para estudiar las propiedades de eficiencia. Ha trabajado en temas de subastas, que digamos de estos días obviamente ha despertado mucho interés. Daniela tiene muchos importantes cargos editoriales, empezando por el rol de editora de Gibbo, que es probablemente una de las revistas que más supieron pensar contracorriente, dar espacio a la frontera de investigación a lo largo de varias décadas de existencia. Por favor, acompáñenme a dar la bienvenida a la invitada de la Cátedra Kerry 2020, Daniela Puzzello. So, Daniela, welcome again. Thanks for accepting the invitation. The floor is yours for about, 70, 75 minutes. I already explained the rule of engagement, and then at the end, we're going to have a session for discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. I understood something because it's similar to Italian. I was really looking forward to my visit and meeting you and seeing Colombia more. But given the situation, it's still nice to be able to share with you some of my research in experimental macro, or my view of what I think experimental macro is. So the first half of the talk is gonna be mostly discussing a little bit the experimental methodology in general and some features that apply or that are more important for macro, similarly to advantages, disadvantages, and potential methodological issues. So let me start by mentioning a little bit of a joke, right? The title of the slides is like economic experiments, what? Because initially, right, the idea of using experiments in economics in general was not really well accepted. Indeed, there is a quote that maybe some of you have already seen, taken from a textbook of Samuelson and Nordhaus in 1985, where they say one possible way of figuring out economic laws is by controlled experiments. So far, so good. But then they add, economists, unfortunately, cannot perform the controlled experiments of chemists or biologists because they cannot easily control other important factors. Like astronomers or meteorologists, they generally must be content largely to observe. So there is this idea that because we are not dealing with inanimate objects, people react, right? It's difficult to really draw economic laws or some regularity potentially from experiments. And Chris Sims, right, himself, he has a nice paper on macroeconomics and methodology, applying the idea of philosophy of science to macro. He mentions economists can do very little experimentation to produce crucial data. And this is particularly true of macroeconomics, okay? This is actually even after, already by 1996, there was some work of Vernon Smith, right? But anyway, there was this resistance in a sense of using experiments in economics. However, thanks to the imagination, the intelligence and grit of several economists, including Nobel Prize winners, I think by now the experimental methodology is more accepted. Here I have a picture of Vernon Smith, who is one of the fathers of experimental economics. He won the Nobel Prize in 2002. And here is the motivation, in a sense, like, why he won the reason why he won the Nobel Prize. And it is for the use of laboratory experiments as a tool in empirical economic analysis, in particular for the study of different market mechanisms. So the bold face was added by me. So why did I add it? Basically to emphasize that we should, we should see experimental economics, laboratory experiments as a complementary tool to other methods. So we should, I think, have more of an integrated approach. And also that while traditionally, I mean, experimental economics, or I shouldn't say traditional, in general, experimental economics is associated by many economists with game theory, right? Experiments in game theory, maybe individual decision-making, interactive but small interactive situations. Actually, Vernon Smith won the prize for the study of different market mechanisms. So in a sense, the seed of the idea of using experimental or a laboratory, if you like, methods, but also more generally experimental methods to study markets was already planted in a sense long a time ago. And then of course, after him, we have many other economists who use experiments. And I mean, here I'm just listing some Nobel Prize winners up to the more recent prize, right, in 2019. Where the Nobel Prize was awarded for the experimental approach to alleviating global poverty. So basically this is just to say that by now, I think people accept, while there was some initial resistance, people accept the methods. What about in macro? Well, I wouldn't say that they're considered standard methods, but I think there is some progress in this direction, and I'm gonna tell you in what areas. So before I discuss, if you like, experimental macroeconomics and what I know about it, let me just discuss if you about macroeconomics. What is macroeconomics? Well, there are several definitions, and I think it might mean different things to different people. But from a broad viewpoint, we can consider macroeconomics as a branch of economics that deals with the performance, structure, behavior, and decision-making of an economy as a whole. Macroeconomists study topics such as GDP, unemployment rates, national income, price indices, output, consumption, unemployment, inflation, saving, investments, energy, international trade, and international finance. So in a sense here, the emphasis is more on, if you like, aggregate phenomena, right? Inflation, unemployment, consumption, saving, and so on and so forth. So what about experimental macroeconomics? There are several surveys, I guess, from different people. My co-author, John Duffy, has a nice, he actually has several surveys. In the one in 2016, he wrote, experimental macroeconomics is a subfield of experimental economics that makes use of controlled laboratory methods to understand aggregate economic phenomena and to test the specific assumptions and predictions of macroeconomic models. So for a more general definition, I think I would go even beyond just the laboratory methods, and actually some examples I'm gonna show you. I mean, while in my research, I basically use laboratory methods, there are some interesting field studies using surveys that are also kind of interesting. And I'm going to show you, I mean, at least some of the findings that that people have discovered using, again, survey experiments in the field. So for a more general definition, basically you could substitute laboratory method just with experimental methods. So what do we consider, I mean, what are experimental methods? Well, the experimental method is a systematic and scientific approach to research in which the researcher manipulates one or more variables and controls and measures any change in other variables. So this is a method that allows you potentially to discover and make causal inferences. So experimental economics is the application of the experimental methods to study economic questions, and typically we have human subjects who participate in the experiment. Not always, in the sense that, I mean, in some cases there were experiments with monkeys and rats, where we try to discover some economic principles using those, but typically it's human subjects. There are different types, of experiments, survey or incentivized. So typically with surveys, we expose subjects to hypothetical settings and we record their responses. Or in other cases, the payment is linked to their performance. That's typically the case for laboratory experiments. There are also field experiments that, again, are conducted in the field. Laboratory experiments instead, typically in lab settings, which are which provide a highly controlled environment. Of course, there are some overlapping, right, between those. There could be some lab in the field studies. There are different types of experiments that have been conducted. And also now, again, because of the pandemic, we'll see more of online experiments. So it's going to be, we will lose maybe a bit of control, but we still don't know. I mean, it's an empirical question. So why lab experiments, right? I mean, and this also, this goes back actually to Roth, and I'm going to discuss some of the reasons that Vernon Smith suggests to run experiments. There are three broad reasons, in a sense, to run experiments. Speaking to theories, that is to test and modify economic theories, and I mean, I guess to test a theory is easier said than done. Whispering into the ears of princes, that is to inform a policy-making process, and searching for facts. So use experiments to collect data to discover and document anomalies or regularities. And one can go a little bit in more detail in these categories. And Smith in 1994 has a nice paper in Economics in the Laboratory, where he discusses again reasons to run to do experiments. For example, to test or select between theories, and you could think also test and select between different equilibrium concepts. If you observe, for example, that theory appears to fail, so behavior is not consistent with the theoretical predictions, then a nice feature of experiments is that you could use those to investigate the reason for the failure. I mean, of course, first you should make sure that the instructions were clear, that your implementation was, in a sense, close to the theoretical environment and so on and so forth, but potentially you could explore the causes of theories apparent for the failure. And actually, and the robustness as well, right? You could see whether indeed, even if you change parameters or environment, you still observe a failure. For the people who are familiar with experimental, a nice example in this category is the ultimatum game, right? Where it was a robust finding was that observations are not in line with the subgame perfect equilibrium, right? The proposers give more than the minimum amount. And at that stage, it wasn't clear whether it was because of other regarding concerns or fear of rejections. And then the dictator game was designed to distinguish between these different explanations. So again, when you observe something that doesn't appear to be consistent with theory, you can use experiments to further explore that. Finally, Furthermore, if on the other hand you find that the theory succeeds, you can work, you can use experiments to explore extreme portions of the parameter or to stress test the model and identify the edges of its validity. So you can explore the robustness of the results. And again, this goes back to Vernon Smith in his markets experiments, where he observed convergence to competitive equilibria, any kind of stress tested the robustness of those results. Other important area that I think it's important also for macro and finance is the idea of comparing institutions. For example, in experimental asset markets, typically people have used the double auction trading institutions. The double auction is a trading institution where people submit bids and asks, and trades happen bilaterally and sequentially within a period. So you have multiple price being realized, as opposite to the, say, call market, where people submit bids and asks, but then those are aggregated to create a demand and supply function. The market clearing price is determined and transactions happen at one price only. So again, this is something where in the field, I mean, different type of institutions are used in different countries and for different assets. So it's difficult to understand, to isolate the impact of the institution itself. And so for example, as stocks tend to be traded more on a centralized platform, while bonds in an over-the-counter market. And again, so since you are changing both the type of asset being traded and the institution, is difficult to understand the impact of the institution itself on price formation. This is something where we could use potentially experiments to better understand the impact of institutions. And actually, the next lecture on Thursday, which is going to be on asset markets, I'm going to be focusing exactly on comparison of trading institutions and how they affect price formation. We can also use experiments to compare different environments. And for example, I have some work where I looked at environments with money and without money and compared the economic allocations and to establish basically whether indeed money increases welfare and enhances exchange compared to environments without it. I'll discuss more of that later. Lab experiments, again, they're useful to establish empirical regularity and as a basis sometimes for new theory, right? In some cases, the world is quite complex, right? We would like to abstract away from some details, but in some cases, we don't know exactly what details matter, what do not matter. And so we could use potentially experiments to help us better understand what are the relevant factor that we should incorporate in a theory. Evaluate policy proposals. For example, you could consider, and this is actually, and especially this, in the context of monetary policy, that's where there is an advantage in the sense of laboratory experiments, because you have a controlled environment and it's difficult to design field experiments, both because they're, I mean, difficult to implement, and also they could have some unintended consequences, political, right, or economic, I mean, from the economic viewpoint that you would like to vote. And it's also, the lab can be really helpful in test bedding or institutional design. That was the case, for example, for Vernon Smith, in the design over the Arizona Stock Exchange, or also auction mechanism. Right? I mean, experiments have provided quite a bit of feedback for the design, in the design of auction mechanism. I mean, we recently, the last Nobel Prize, right, was won by two theorists who also spent quite a bit, their career in improving the design of auctions. So these the last three here that I'm mentioning, reasons to conduct experiments, there is written added because they were not in the original paper of Vernon. So of course the experiments I think are quite a nice tool for teaching. I think they help convey some economic principles more effectively. They have also been used, there is some controversy here, to estimate parameters, for example, to estimate the degree of risk aversion. I have a paper where we use consumption and production, basically game between buyers and sellers to estimate the bargaining weight. And again, in the context of monetary models. But you could potentially use, I mean, there are studies where experiments are used to estimate the parameters of the model. And finally, important, especially to macro and monetary economics, is the idea of equilibrium selection, okay? So in some cases, we have multiple equilibria. Equilibrium selection, in some cases, theory doesn't help us to determine which equilibrium is more likely to arise. So experiments can be can shed some light on that, right? By the way, actually, micro, this has been well accepted, right? We know it for various games, right? Minimum effort games, coordination games, more recently, repeated games, right? But for macro, this is also important because we typically have, there are multiple equilibria. And actually Lucas himself in a paper in the Journal of Business in 1996, he wrote the following. The issue involves a question concerning how collections of people behave in a specific situation. Economic theory does not resolve the question. One can imagine other principles that would, but this cannot rule out the possibility that still other principles might resolve it quite differently. It is hard to see what can advance the discussion short of assembling a collection of people, putting them in the situation of interest, and observing what they do. This is exactly, in a sense, what we do with experiments, right? And actually, this is also something that at that time, this was in the context of overlapping generation models where you have multiple equilibria, both also stationary and non-stationary. And the area of overlapping generation models, monetary models, actually Shyam Sander and his co-authors have been an important contribution. I'm gonna discuss some of that. So again, important for equilibrium selection. In my research, actually, experiments were also helpful in determining whether the monetary equilibrium and the non-monetary equilibrium would arise, because the equilibria depends on the beliefs of agents and whether they think that other people are going to accept money in exchange. And so that was another good reason for me to go to the lab. Other reasons are to test the predictions of the model or assumptions of the model. For example, one of the tenets of macro or many macro models is the idea that expectations are rational, but there is some evidence that that's not the case. Also, especially relevant for macro is in some cases the field data is not available or it's not possible, right, to collect field data, again, either for political reasons or ethical reasons. Or in some cases, there are endogeneity issues, right? And so it's not easy to make causal inferences based on field data. In this case, experiments can be quite helpful. They can be helpful also to test bed policies and institutions. So, eventually maybe you would like to implement the policy in the field, but it would make sense to first start at a smaller scale, for example, in the lab, to ask whether policies work as intended. If not, why? To maybe identify some heuristics that people may use to make decisions, and so construct potentially better guide, I mean, have some guidance in the construction of better policies. See, I mean, related to that, depending right on your findings, this could help also explore the robustness of model predictions to play by subjects who might be boundedly rational, their non-expected utility maximizers, have other regarding of concern, and so on and so forth, right? So basically, there are several reasons that, I mean, that would, for which experiments are useful also for macro. Now, let me tell you, why do I think it's also a good time to do macro experiments in macro, okay? Well, there are several reasons. So from the theoretical viewpoint, micro-funded models have been developed, and these are more easily implementable, right? They are amenable to laboratory implementation. Secondly, also computational methods now, I mean, they're quite advanced. They allow you then to solve your models also with heterogeneous agents. And I think that it is important in a sense to have a dialogue between computational models and experiments, in the sense that experiments can gain from these from computational models, right? These richer models, but at the same time, also the theorist can gain from experiments, because experiments can help us discipline the model, okay, and better understand what type of heterogeneity to include in the model, and or estimate parameters, right, to provide some more discipline, right, to the model. Also, another important feature, I'm going to discuss also this later when I'll talk about some of the methodological issues or some of the disadvantages. One important aspect that I think will help the growth of experimental methods as applied to macro is that now we can do also online experiments, right? So we're not restricted anymore by the physical size of the lab, okay? That as big as can be typically is still around maybe 40 computer station or something like that. So we could implement large markets online, right? So I'm actually working with a student, and hopefully on Thursday we'll give you a demonstration of the asset markets and how we are doing them online. Actually, my colleague Harley Williams also had already started doing some experiments, but asynchronous experiments. So not all subjects were submitting their decision at the same time, but all across periods. And so, I mean, these are possible. And I think for some people who think, what can I learn from an economy of 10, 14 people? Or 20 people, I mean, one can show that, first of all, I mean, in his case, actually in the context of the asset market research, my colleague was showing that many of the patterns that we were observing in the lab were replicated also in large markets. So again, this should help, these technological advances should help address some of the concerns that people might have about the scale, like laboratory experiments being of a small scale. So briefly here, some of you again might be familiar with this, but regarding laboratory experiments specifically, Smith has a very nice paper where he kind of establishes, if you like, the main principles of experimental economics, okay, and again, focusing mainly on laboratory experiments. The title is Microeconomic System as an Experimental Science. And he basically mentions, again, that one of the advantages of the experimental or experimental economics is that we have much more control, and we can induce also potentially preferences, right? So, but there are some principles that we will need to follow, right? The first thing is, of course, very important. Whatever reward medium we use, so this is the principle of monotonicity or non-satiation, subjects should prefer higher amounts of the reward medium. And that's typically why we use cash or money to pay subjects in our experiments. This is not universal. For example, there are some experiments with children where children are paid with toys. Okay, so normally they wouldn't care right about necessarily about money at that stage. And also some people in some cases use extra credit, but I mean extra credit depending on the experiment that you have might not be easily accepted because you should make sure that you do not penalize any of the students and stuff like that. But in some research I've seen, it doesn't seem to affect they seem to be motivated also by extra credit. But I mean, the most accepted medium of exchange is a medium of reward. The medium is really money and cash. The other important principle is saliency. So in other words, the reward earned by subjects should be directly linked to their performance. So it should depend on their choices and possibly the one of other participants as specified by the experiment. So typically we avoid the flat payments or because then, I mean, their performance is not going to be driven, right? I mean, their decisions do not affect the amount of money that they would receive. So this is an important principle. Another important principle is dominance. And I think this is, in a sense, the hardest one to make sure that we have full control of, but we try our best. Is that the reward structure should dominate any subjective cost associated with participation in the activities of an experiment. So basically the main idea is that indeed subjects' utility should be mainly affected by the reward medium rather than other factors such as, for example, fatigue, boredom, experimental demand effect, other preferences that are not the one that we induce in the lab, and so on and so forth. So this, I mean, I'm stressing this is important also, especially for macro in a sense, because, or for more complex experiments in general, because in a sense, the more complex is the experiment, the more likely it might be that other factors might play a role. So, but still, I mean, we should make sure that they're appropriately incentivized. So here a bit of a break, right? Given that, we're going on for some time already. Other principles that we have, right, in experimental economics, at least, I mean, according to my colleague, Jimmy Walker is one, again, I guess, second generation experimental economist, immediately following Vernon Smith, Plot, and so on and so forth. He told me about this KISS principle. What does it mean? Keep it simple, stupid. I don't know how familiar you are with this, but the main idea would be, again, to try to keep it as the environment as simple as possible, again, to minimize also all these other factors that could play a role. And then I came up with a different slogan, like KICK, right? Basically, keep it clear, kid, right? So what am I saying? Like, in some cases, for especially for macro, right? Or but even not for macro, even micro, if you take the more dynamic games, the micro games, right? The environment is automatically a little bit more complex, okay? But I don't think it's a reason to kill the research agenda. It's just that you need to spend maybe more effort into the design of the experiments. The instructions, the instructional period at the beginning, right? We typically distribute the instruction, there is a questionnaire, stuff like that. So I think it is still possible that to keep the design as clear as possible and still learn something basically from experiments. And also a principle that we typically follow is to focus on treatment differences rather than specific point predictions. So advantages and disadvantages of experiments. I think one advantage that is difficult to argue against, right? I mean, people would recognize is the control and short distance to internal validity. Advantages are, for example, subjects are randomly assigned to treatment conditions so we can avoid self-selection issues. It's possible to change exogenous conditions to make causal inferences. For example, how does the trading institution affect price formation? Variables that are not observed in the field can be observed in the lab and are under the control of the experimenter. So again, in the context of asset markets, we have control on the fundamental value of the asset and the type of interactions that can take place, let's say, across traders, which is not true necessarily on the field, right? We don't have a clear understanding on the fundamental value of an asset. We can also control information available to subjects, and very importantly, and also for macro, is the replicability, okay? The fact that suppose we find something using an experiment, we can replicate to, again, going back to one of the reasons to do experiments, right? If you find support or you find that the theory fails, right? You can replicate and basically validate your finding, further validate your finding. What about the criticism, right? The typical criticism that one gets, and it's actually, of course, especially relevant for macro, because with macro, typically people want to do policy, right? It's the external validity criticism. Do the results obtained in the lab generalize to the field? Okay, so there's actually kind of a criticism that you could apply to lab experiments, except for the ones that strictly focus on testing theory, right? You could apply to many experiments. Well, here my idea would be going actually to the lowest bullet point, is that I think we should have a more integrated approach to research, and I mean, think in a more cooperative way, in a way, right? So first, if one wanted to be really strict, the external validity applies to other methods as well, because typically we have that certain results are obtained for particular data sets that we have available, right? For specific countries, or right? So we have, even in that case, it's not clear how generalizable the result is. Also, even if you are thinking to go into the field to close the gap, right, or to decrease external validity issues, still, it is important, probably in many cases, as a first step, it makes sense to go to the lab. Because if you don't find a support for a specific conjecture in the lab, it's likely that it's not going to be supported in the field where you have much less control and there are many other things interacting at the same place. So this is at the same time. So this is a similar point in a sense that you could use still, the laboratory is still important because it can inform field experiments and guide the design. And still, imperfect evidence might be better than no evidence at all. So this is the external value. Other criticism that people typically also say that it's related to the external validity in a sense is that lab experiments are unrealistic and artificial, right? So people say, again, what do we learn? They are too simple. We're not really capturing the phenomenon of interest and so on and so forth. But again, this is, I think it's more of a, I mean, cheap criticism, so to speak, right? We can always raise it, but in a sense, if we think also about the value of theory, it's in its simplicity, right? Models are simplified frameworks that are designed to illustrate more complex processes. And this is similar for experiments. I mean, we all agree that the world is complex, but we have some ideas of some things that might matter most or more than others. And we can use experiments and simplify, right, to isolate certain mechanisms to gain insights into the phenomenon. So the view here is if you accept that simplicity might be indeed a virtue that can help better understand relationship of interest and make a main mechanism, then I think one could accept that, again, lab experiments can, despite being simple, right, can still provide some insights on more complex phenomena. And then here I just have some quotes of, I guess, Plot and Smith to add to, well, I guess we're facing this criticism, right, at the moment of establishing the experimental methods in economics. Plot writes, while laboratory processes are simple in comparison to naturally occurring processes, they are real processes in the sense that real people participate for real and substantial profits and follow real rules in doing so. It is precisely because they're real that they're interesting. So in other words, I mean, we are still constructing real economies. And then of course, if you think something is missing, you can always build and incorporate other factors that you think are interesting. Other criticism, subjects are students. There is actually a nice, and the students, people use it to say, typical, at least when I present in audiences that do not consist of experimentalists only, I get the people say subjects are students, meaning subjects are kind of idiots, right? But I have the opposite view, right? I'm actually very smart. If at all, if we're missing something, it's because we're using the smarter part of the population. But I mean, just abstracting away from this joke, there are people who have compared, right, students' decisions to professional traders, for example, and they found that some of the results we find in the lab are robust to different subject pools. So again, this is something that if you think it's extremely is an issue, you could overcome, especially now also with online, the fact that we can do online experiments maybe allow us also to reach more easily subject pools that we couldn't reach before. Now there is also, and I was reading at some point a paper by Rachel Crozon, which was also about the experimental methodology, and there is kind of a nice joke there too, that said that students are real people, only younger. Right, so they, again, something that could be addressed. So another criticism that people tell you, and it might be important also in the context of macro, is that subjects are inexperienced. But again, now you could, I mean, you can potentially train, be more careful in the training part of the session, right? You can also potentially recruit them again after they participated in certain markets. So you can address this type of criticism. Number of participants is small. I'm gonna show you that, I mean, first of all, there are some studies that show that depending on the situation, 10 or 12 traders might be large enough, right, to reach, for example, the competitive equilibrium. But again, using the online platform, now we can we can reach more participants. Stakes are small. Again, people have looked at different stake sizes, and they found that there is a difference, mainly the difference between not paying and pay. And then when you pay little, typically there is more noise than when you pay more, right? So, and then experimental demand effect, again, there are ways that you could address that. I'm not gonna go into details, but. So overall, anyway, the view, I mean, at least my view, is that laboratory experiments are complementary to other methods, right? Or to field experiments, to happenstance data, to survey data. And what's the most appropriate method by depend on the data availability as well as the constraints. I mean, I definitely agree that if we use an experiment, we should have a good motivation to use those. And for example, I mean, I'm gonna show you probably in the third lecture an application of experiments to study the Friedman rule in the laboratory. And there it's again difficult to implement the policy in the field. So it makes sense to go to the lab. By now, as I mentioned, there are experiments have been used in many fields of economics, individual decision-making, game theory, market setting, finance, dynamic and repeated games, macroeconomics and monetary economics. So here a bit of a American expression, right? The sky is the limit, right? So some methodological issues, and also going back to this idea that we have a small scale, right? And you cannot learn much from laboratory experiments. The question is, how many is many, right? For models, if you like, right? And because typically, I mean, many cases in the models, we assume a continuum of agents or many traders, right? So how many is many? And actually there is some work, already very early work by Vernon Smith, where, which also is part of his, part of the reasons for which he was awarded the Nobel Prize, is that he discovered that basically a robust funding in the context of goods markets is that even with a smaller number of traders, let's say 10 to 20, you would observe competitive outcomes. Okay, so indeed there are experiments that indicate that you do not need many subjects to attain competitive equilibrium outcomes. And Smith in his paper writes, even when numbers are small, there are strong tendencies for a supply and demand competitive equilibrium to be attained as long as one is able to prohibit collusion and to maintain absolute publicity of all bids, offers, and transactions. I mean, I'm saying this because, of course, the notion of competitive equilibrium is also central to macroeconomics. And the way he did it, it's actually, I'm going to discuss briefly. He was assigning some roles. So some of the subjects were buyers, some were sellers. Buyers were assigned reservation values, meaning some... That would be basically the maximum amount that they're willing to pay, right? So it was the value of the object to you. So you wouldn't want to pay more than the value of the object. To the sellers, it was assigning marginal costs. And this is part of this induced value theory, right? I mean, this idea that you induce values and preferences, right, on in the lab. And then what it did, how was this helping to determine the competitive equilibrium? Well, the values and costs were aggregated. So the values were ordered from highest to lowest, generating step demand curves. The costs were ordered from lowest to highest, generating supply curves. So a graph, similar graph to this. So here, for example, there were some buyers who were given this value, another buyer this value, and so on and so forth. So basically, you would have the market clearing price by intersecting the induced demand and supply. So of course, the big question was, if we leave people just to trade, in this particular case was a double auction, right? Will we observe convergence to this price? And indeed, that's what he found, okay? So basically, as long as there was information of the bids and asks of traders, public information, convergence was established. So basically, this is, and then part of his research was also to stress test and to check whether this result was robust or not. And it was found to be robust. Another methodological issue that I ran into in my research also is that many macroeconomic models assume infinite horizon, okay? And in monetary economics, it's kind of natural because if the horizon were finite, of course, at the very end, nobody would take money, right? Because I cannot spend it in the future. So when we are in period T minus one, I also wouldn't accept money from anybody because I know I wouldn't be able to spend in period T and so on and so forth. So by backward induction, money would not have value. So typically in micro-funded models of money, you have some way of, you have kind of an infinite horizon environment. Or even in the overlapping generation, when you only have two period generations, they go forever, right? So there's this idea of infinite horizon. I mean, of course, the question is, how long then is forever in the lab? Can you really do this infinite horizon, if you like, in the lab? Well, here I think it's interesting to have the perspective of theorists themselves, here in particular Osborne and Rubinstein. I mean, they apply this for the infinite repeated games, but it applies, of course, also to any infinite horizon kind of environment. What's interesting, they mentioned that in our view, a model should attempt to capture the features of reality that the players perceive. The fact that a situation has a horizon that is in some sense finite does not necessarily imply that the best model of the situation has a finite horizon. So the main idea here is that if they play a game so frequently that the horizon approaches only very slowly, then they may ignore the existence of the horizon entirely until its arrival is imminent. And until this point, the strategic thinking may be better captured by game with an infinite horizon. Okay, so the idea is that you shouldn't take necessarily the theory of infinite games literally, in the sense that they apply literally only to infinite horizon situation, as long as the interaction is long enough that intertemporal incentives play a role, probably a more dynamic environment, or in this particular case, the theory of infinite repeated games might be a better description of behavior, right? And the way that typically these infinite horizons are actually environmental is implemented in the context of repeated games, but again, one can transfer them to dynamic infinite horizon games, relies on this interpretation. Typically, they're implemented through a probability of continuation. And this is the interpretation that is given, for example, in this paper by the book by Mailat and Samuelson. An interpretation of infinite repeated games is of games with probabilistic continuation, where the probability of continuation is given by the discount factor. Okay, so the main idea, I would just jump in the interest of time, just jump to the last one. One does not have to believe that the game will last forever, but must believe that it could last an arbitrarily long time. However, this is a bit, so people say, okay, I just use a probability of continuation, it's kind of the same, but still theoretically speaking, potentially an issue because you see, you need to have the people believe that it could last an arbitrary long time, but in the lab, you could run into the situation where the sequence is still going on and the end of experiment is approaching, right? So basically, technically speaking, still there could be some issues. And that's the one that I face again when I, not so much when I present in front of experimentalists or potentially theorists who are used to experiments, but that I run into when I present in front of theorists. So in order to do that, because again, this could be a concern, especially for macro, because the probability of continuations might be quite high because we assume high discount factors, right? If you like, in macro models. There are potentially ways to still be able to implement these type of models and to assign basically continuation value of a game. Okay, so you could compute the continuation value, assign this value to subjects. So again, I'm not gonna bore you with details here, but this is done by Brutel and Kameke for repeated games. And I have a paper with Janet Zhang and Kathy Zhang where we apply this to monetary economies. And we do not find big difference between economies that are implemented through random termination and through this other method where you basically would go around this idea that you cannot, that you cannot implement infinite horizon economies. So I'm not gonna tell you the details, but if you're interested, I'll be happy to talk more about it. So let's go now maybe to the most fun part here. So I'm gonna describe some applications of experiments to macro. There has been quite a bit being done. Of course, my specialty, so to speak, is monetary economics. There have been done in financial, in finance, in particular in experimental asset markets. There are also experiments which have been done in dynamic intertemporal optimization, trying to understand better consumption and savings decisions and asking questions whether people smooth consumption optimally or not. Expectation formation, inflation expectations as a policy tool, I mean, of course, coordination problems like on bank runs, sunspots, global games, and so on and so forth. So my view is that many questions remain to be explored. And maybe a limitation is also that sometimes, I mean, there are some in consumption savings, I think there could be more. I mean, it's similar within the context of monetary economics, there could be more. In some cases, you run in some, you could run in some critics. Like, for example, one of the things I ran into recently, I'm using some micro-funded models to look at money, and I applied those to think about essentiality of money and basically under what conditions monetary exchange arises as an equilibrium arrangement and so on and so forth. And then my co-author and I, this is some paper, a paper with John Duffy, we also use the same type of environment to explore the Friedman rule, which is a monetary policy rule, right? If you like, the mother of all monetary policies. But then, I mean, we run into, for example, some reviewers who say, oh, you're using the same setting as in the other paper. And so even though we were looking at a different question, right, it was perceived as not being original or novel. So again, I'm not sure this is kind of an anecdote, but there might be some of the reasons why maybe there are no more, even more experiments on consumption and savings. Or, I mean, there are some experiments, for example, on the Lucas asset pricing model as well, but I think there could be more. We do not object to having many experiments on the prisoner's dilemma games, or, you know, the right now is more like the lying, right? There is a lot of experiments on lying, or, when it was the time of the ultimatum game, we had many experiments with, so I think there are still many things that deserve more exploration within what has been already explored, as well as new issues that, depending on what you are working on, might be of interest to you. So basically these are in bold because these are the examples that I'm gonna discuss where experiments have been used. And I'm gonna start actually with expectation as a policy tool, which is not part of my research. And it's actually uses survey and experiments, survey experiments in the field. Okay, this is part of a research agenda. It uses survey experiments in the field. And why would be that? What is the advantage of using experiments? Well, people are trying to establish the causal effects of inflation expectations on economic decisions that, again, are difficult to determine using field data. Okay? Because, for example, is it that I consume more because I expect higher inflation, or I expect higher inflation because I am consuming a lot? Stuff like that, right? So there are things you cannot really test with the field data without experiments. And then I'm gonna discuss, hopefully this will cover it today. I think we have enough time for today. Then I'm gonna discuss monetary economics, experiments monetary economics, and the questions that have been asked is, for example, as I mentioned, is money welfare improving? Do certain monetary policies work as intended? Is money neutral? What are the welfare costs of inflation, and so on and so forth. And again, is why do you use an experiment? Well, again, for example, celebrated propositions in monetary economics as the Friedman rule is difficult to test in the field. And the other application is gonna be laboratory asset markets and the comparison of trading institutions. And again, why different institutions used in different countries and for different assets? So it's difficult to understand the isolated impact of the institution on price formation. So by the way, in terms of order, today I'm gonna discuss briefly the results and the insights from this from this research agenda, expectations that looks at expectations and how they affect economic decisions. And on Thursday, the laboratory asset markets, and hopefully I'll have you participate in an experiment so that then we'll discuss the environment and some of the finding in the research on some of the findings in experimental economics on laboratory asset markets. And then the last lecture is going to be on monetary economics. Okay, so let me discuss this application of experiments to monetary economics. Sorry, to macro. And actually here it's a completely different framework than the one I work with, because I work with this.
Daniela, 15 minutes.
Yes, search models of money. Okay, so these micro-funded models were actually money is a medium of exchange, and there are completely different channels that affect this is more of a new Keynesian framework, right? And I'm working more on a different framework. But I think these are interesting experiments, both independently, but also because I think the some readings, my reading of some of the findings that they have, is that actually there is room for experiments to better understand some of the puzzles, if you like, that they have. So let me just anyway tell you what this is about. And this is a literature, this title, Inflation Expectations as a Policy Tool, is a title of a, if you like, literature review paper by Coi Bion, Gorodinchenko, Kumar, and Pedemonte. I think it's forthcoming in JIE 2020, which kind of gives a literature review on this of the experiments that have been conducted in this area. So the first question is, of course, why would you want to use expectations as a policy tool, right? We typically have that inflation expectations are anchored, and we wouldn't want to mess up, right, those expectations. Well, their starting point is that, I mean, as the recent crisis has shown, when you hit a zero lower bound on interest rates, you kind of constrain monetary policy. You cannot anymore implement monetary policies by changing in the interest rates, because you hit, right, the lower bound. So people started to think more creatively about monetary policy. And what they propose, I mean, Gorodnichenko, Coimbion, and co-authors, they have several papers. Actually, this is again the literature review that gives more of an overview of the research, right, that has been conducted so far, is that, well, we could use expectations as a policy tool. So we cannot work on interest rates, nominal interest rates, but we could change inflation expectations. And that could affect potentially behavior, right, and economic decisions. And what's the theoretical channel hypothesized, right? The idea would be, well, if we increase expected inflation, since nominal interest rates are locked, right, because you hit the lower bound, you would decrease the perception of real interest rates, and this would increase potentially spending and investment, okay? So again, monetary policy, by affecting expectations, could have an impact. Now, of course, questions that are important here is, if you want to use the as a policy tool, first, it's important to understand maybe better, right, how do households and firms form expectations? Do they pay attention to inflation, right? Expectations. So does information, do they pay attention, first of all, to inflation expectations? Second, if they don't, and I'm going to show you, indeed, there is some evidence to show that there is inattention to inflation, is there a way that we could still affect inflation expectations? For example, we provide some information. Do people react and update their information, their inflation expectations? And if that's the case, if you indeed figure out that you can affect expectations, because of course, for all this to work, you will need to be able to affect expectations. Do expectations affect economic decisions? And finally, how do expectations affect economic decisions? Right? So do they affect economic decisions in the direction that you were hypothesizing, right? The idea that you could use inflation expectations for expansionary purposes. So what I would say is that I think the research so far has given satisfactory answer to the first four questions, but there are still, I think, open questions about the last one, and in particular the channels, which is the most important in a sense for policy, right, implementations, better, and the understanding of how changes in expectations or affect economic decisions. Okay, and that's where I think there is some room for experiments to take place. So let me start with this graph. So this is basically a graph. Of course, if you want to use expectations as a policy tool, you need to better understand how expectations are formed. And also, in principle, you care not only about expectations of professional forecasters and financial market participants, but presumably you would care also about the households, because these are the people who react, right, to the policy and firms, right? And this figure basically reports the 1 year ahead inflation expectations for different agents for the United States. And the black line reports the one of professional forecasters that, as you can see, is around, I mean, in the 2000 becomes around 3%, 2%, right? The red dotted line is of financial markets. So as you can see, the black and the red kind of are close to each other and are overall, I would say, relatively accurate. However, households, you see the blue line, they are quite higher than professional forecaster and financial market participant. And for firms, we only have a dotted point, because one point of the research is also to highlight that while there is a lot of there are a lot of surveys, right, study on households, there is not much done on firms, okay? So again, you can see that, this would highlight in general, households and firm expectations are not well approximated by professional forecaster expectations, and that we should care, of course, if we want the policy, for policy reasons, we should also care about households and firms. The other points that they highlight, I mean, it was, part of these the research findings out of the, again, this broad research agenda, which consists not only of their work, but their work of others, is that there is in general inattention to inflation, okay? Basically, people don't pay too much attention, especially in countries like the US, where inflation rates have been low. But if you go to countries with high inflation rates, like which have experienced high inflation rates, like Argentina, Ukraine, Uruguay, people are, the expectations of households and firms are also more accurate. So anyway, I mean, these two things tell us, okay, expectations, we should care also about expectations of households and firm. Overall, there seems to be inattention to inflation. But then does it mean we should, there is no way then that we can impact, we can have an impact on inflation expectations? I mean, given that people do not pay attention. And they say, no, it's not the case. They did in a series of studies, both on firms and households, randomized control trials. Okay, so basically, for example, in the recent study, which is forthcoming in a QJE, they took, a sample of Italian firms. So this is done by the Bank of Italy, a survey, where a subsample of the firms, I think 2/3 of the firms, before submitting their inflation expectations, are given information on past inflation rates. And for the other part of the sample, that's not the case. And what they observe is that indeed the firms that are given information on past inflation rates submit different inflation expectations, of course, more accurate inflation expectations than the firms who are not given this information. Okay, so basically this is saying we can have an impact on inflation expectations. Okay, so it's possible as policymakers to impact inflation expectations. But then, of course, the very important question is, okay, we can have an impact on inflation expectations. I mean, they discuss also the duration and other things, right? But do expectations affect economic decisions? Because in principle, even if we have an impact on expectations, but then people do not react to those firms or households, then we do not have much hope for the policy to work. And here, what again, their experiments show, and they have several papers, both the people I cited, as well as you can look at their paper for more citations, survey experiments appear to say yes. So firms react to those, and also households. Okay, households, there are more study from other people, I guess, than from this team of researchers. But there is a response. The problem, the issue, I mean, which, and again, it's not necessary. I mean, it kind of calls for more research, is that it's not systematic. So for example, for Italian firms, they found that they respond to inflation expectations. So the revised, let's say, the higher are the inflation expectations about inflation, the lower is the employment. So they decrease the employment. So they actually react in the opposite direction of what hypothesized by the model. While they find something different for New Zealand, okay? And they include, I mean, I send you to the paper, I would refer you to the paper, the QJE one, where they discuss some mechanisms. They included actually in the survey some questions to better understand the mechanism, right, for the results that they found. But I think that the mechanism is still quite unclear. And there is room also for lab experiments or formal controlled experiments, if you like, to shed light on the channels and the mechanisms through which inflation expectations might potentially affect economic decisions. And I think also experiments can be very useful in the context of this research area in terms of designing better surveys. Indeed, it's mentioned also in this paper that the definition of inflation ranges from the change in the price index you pay to inflation as measured by the consumer price index. And again, depending on how you phrase the question, you might get different answers. There are actually Armentier has done some work also in the area. So it can be helpful to design, basically experiments can be helpful to design better surveys, decrease this way also measurement error, and also to improve communication strategies. For example, you could, in this particular case, the intervention was to show information about past inflation, right? But there could be some other information that you might give, for example, about inflation targeting and so on and so forth. So again, experiments here could help you better understand effective communication strategies, both in terms of frequency and the type of communication. So I think I would conclude here for today, right? You told me I had 5 minutes, right? So, and we can continue with monetary economics. I guess the third, right? In the third lecture, I'll discuss more monetary economics. But okay. If there are any questions, please.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot, Daniela. It was super interesting. So I open the floor for questions. Again, if someone prefer to do it in Spanish, just write to the chat. Otherwise, raise your hand or unmute and just do the question. Just we can have about like 15 minutes of discussion now. So if anyone to start.
Yes, I have a question. Hi, everyone.
My name is Iván Leonardo. I am professor, auxiliary professor at the Universidad Nacional. I do macroeconomics, but I never have made an experiment. So my question is very simple. My plan is to start a PhD next year. So I want to ask you, how to begin? How to begin? I have a lot of macro theory in my head, but putting this macro theory or these hypotheses in an experiment is a work that I've never made. Yes. So that's my question. There is an introductory book or what kind of research can I start to do with whom? In order to start to exploit this useful tool? Mm-hmm. That's my question.
Okay, so maybe we can collect two or three questions.
Yes, okay, sounds good.
Mm. Any other of the macroeconomists want to intervene or anybody from the public?
Uh,
Ivan, please.
Hi, thank you for your talk. It was very interesting. I have a kind of a questions about, first is why did you make an experiment about monetary and non-monetary economics? I mean, I understand that in the conventional approach, you have this idea about, you know, barter economies, but I mean, you know that that has been shown that it's not true. There's like a lot of work by anthropologists, the work by Michael Hodgson, they showed that this idea of barter economy hasn't existed. So why, what is the meaning of having an experiment about non-money and non-monetary economics and monetary economics? Other questions is like how do you deal with the problem of uncertainty, right? With the problem of non-ergodicity of the world. That is something that Paul Davidson presents a lot, and it's also presented by Keynes itself in his work, when he says, you don't know what is going to happen. You just do this, you just create this type of, you know, institutions, contracts that help you to live your life, but you never know what to do. That's why I think, I don't remember if it's Hicks or someone else who said that in macroeconomics, you cannot do experiments because you deal with a lot of things that are not possible to control, right? So it's just like, how do you deal with these problems that are there, you know, the uncertainty thing. Other question, when you showed the thing about the monetary thing, about the interest rate with the Friedman rule, is there any intervention with them? I mean, there is any communication with the Treasury in your experiment? Because when you get them the interest rate close to zero, is because there is a lot of intervention by the fiscal policy. Mm-hmm. So you have this intervention. There is the what the people like Scott Wilder talks, the complementarity between monetary policy and fiscal policy. You cannot think just that monetary policy is what the central bank does, but it's whatever affects the interest rate. So how do you deal with that? And also, but I think you respond about that, is the problems of the fallacy of composition. When you have that, you are doing experiments that are very useful to understand something in like in a small group, but that is not like, it doesn't have the problem of the fallacy of composition that you cannot extrapolate this to the aggregates. And finally, the problem of the aggregates, how do you do aggregation since, you know, the Cambridge controversy, you have that you cannot do this kind of aggregation. So how do you deal with that? How do you face that problem? So far, I think this is my questions. Thank you again.
I think it's enough for the first round. So if you wanna answer, and then people please think at a potential other question, and I'll leave you the floor afterwards. Okay.
Yes, I mean, regarding Ivan's question, Leonardo, right? Because you're both called Ivan, right? So Ivan Leonardo, I mean, there is really, there are some books that discuss methodological issues, but our methodological points about experiments, but typically really you learn by doing. So this is not true only for macro, but also if you do a micro experiments where there is not much has been done before, you need to figure out how to implement, right? For example, if it's the model. And that's where the beauty, I think, of experiments, which many people who do not do experiments kind of tend to discount, is exactly how you bring if it's a model to life, right? So even in my research, when I'm doing monetary economics, I guess I'm still at the stage of better understanding what could be easier way to implement, right? This was this KISS principle or KIC principle, or keep it clear, kid. It might require you several iterations in a sense, right? So I would say there is no, I mean, no textbook, I mean, but it's the same how to construct a model, right? It's not that there is a textbook on how to construct a model. You need to figure out, in some case, by yourself, if you are absorbing a new phenomenon. So yeah, overall, you will need to see if it's about a market, you could look at how people have implemented market and what type of institutions. That's where it's come, this double auction or call market, or I'm going to discuss the Tatelman next time, but you will need to check, like if you are implementing markets, what has been done in that context and so on and so forth, right? So regarding, there were several questions from Ivan Velasquez. So let me tell you a little bit about, okay, my question about the money versus no money case, okay? Where I was studying the essentiality, if you like, the questions about the essentiality of money. Basically, actually, the main idea of the environment was that you had the multiple equilibria again, right? Somewhere money had value, okay? Somewhere money had no value, depending on expectations. So if you were expecting other people to, and this money here was, we were giving tokens to the subjects, and these tokens were intrinsically worthless and inconvertible. So these were fiat money, directly fiat money, okay? So it's not like historically you were going to different phases like shares, commodity money, other things, right? Even money itself, in a sense, evolved over time, and it was part of the experimenting of the economy in a sense, right? So here we were just giving directly fiat money. And in addition to that, because the population in the lab is finite and not a continuum, there were also, you could construct other equilibria using folk type theorems, which actually were even more efficient than money here, because money, because of the discount factor, had some there were some inefficiencies, right, associated with money. So basically, it was more the idea of testing which equilibrium again was more likely to arise. If there was no medium of exchange, would subjects figure out a way to still support good outcomes or not? And what we found there is that indeed, whenever there is this. In the environments where there was fiat money, they were achieving higher cooperation rates than when there was no money. Okay, so that was from the theoretical viewpoint to show that money could have value, even though, again, it was given by the beliefs, if you like, of subjects. Regarding your question about the Friedman rule, okay? I'm gonna discuss more, I guess, on Monday, next Monday. But my environment was much simpler, right? Because I kind of implemented exactly an hypothetical economy, right? And actually there were not even explicit interest rates, okay? There was only one asset, which was money, but there is an opportunity cost of holding money, which is given by the discount factor, right? The fact that if you have a unit of money today, it could be worth, it is worth less, right, tomorrow because of the discount factor. And still you could use the changes in the money supply, for example. I mean, we look at different implementations, but you could change you could, for example, contract the money supply, see whether it would generate deflation, and so offset the opportunity cost of holding money. So in this particular case, it was a very simple implementation of the Friedman rule. And by the way, we are not cheating, because Friedman, in his chapter, when he discusses the Friedman rule, he starts with what he calls a hypothetical simple society, where he doesn't have bonds, nothing, he only has money, okay? So that's, so we were not, in the future it might be interesting to enrich the environment and put more explicitly interest rates and so on, but I'll show you that even in this simple case, the rule didn't work as intended, and we're still at the stage of figuring out better why. We have some conjectures, again, when I discuss on next Monday, I'll see more. And then about your idea of extrapolating, right? And this issue of aggregation, I think these are very important issues. And sometimes with models, it's not always easy, right? This is important. Also theoretically, it's definitely important and at the forefront of macro. But there are indeed computational models, right, being developed. Part of it is just to do some, right? You have some heterogeneous agents models and you use computational methods to solve for the model. So what I would say is that in a sense, it might be easier to understand aggregation in the lab because you have data on the individual behavior. Okay? So in a sense, that's what I was saying at some point, there should be a dialogue because you could use experiments to discipline some elements of the model, but at the same time, you need also the model to get an idea about predictions, right? And so it could be some kind of back and forth going on there. And I mean, again, your question, how large is large? I mean, it might depend on the environment. In the context that Vernon Smith, it seemed that the 20 traders were enough. I mean, in the context of my experiments, I work also with 14 subjects. And what I need, I basically need that they are price takers, right? And that they do not manipulate, they do not think that they have an impact on prices, right? And they can manipulate prices. And that seems to be the case. But I mean, I agree that depending on the question you have in mind, you might need larger markets. And I mean, it's kind of an empirical question, depending on, it might depend on the context, how large is large. But I can tell you regarding asset markets, where we typically are 9 traders, I'm working with a student to make large markets of more than 100 traders and see whether some of the patterns that were found in the lab generalize to these larger markets and better understand basically this issue of the large scale. And then about the uncertainty, you were saying something about uncertainty, right? I mean, I'm not sure I fully understand the question, but I mean, I agree there is uncertainty in the world, right? In the field, but there is also a bit of uncertainty in the, I mean, there is uncertainty as well in the lab, right? And I mean, I think it's an empirical question whether you can uncover empirical regularities or not. And I mean, for example, the study I just showed you, right? I mean, which is anyway, literature review, which they did experiments. I mean, I guess you would agree with me, these are macro experiments. I mean, they're done with survey and in the field, right? And I mean, potentially, let me go up actually. Potentially still, I mean, there is this issue because we need to figure out, I mean, I guess if you want to do policy, right? It's really important to understand the channels, right? But I mean, before completely abandoning the idea, okay, maybe we cannot uncover the channels and stuff like that. It's because, you know, I mean, in the end, the main point is heterogeneity. Like, what does it mean inflation? I mean, how do I react to inflation? Well, it depends on if I'm using money to buy things. If instead, I mean, I already have some investments in, I don't know, I already have properties, right? It depends on if you are a lender or you are a borrower, right? So I think it's difficult to create like a principle. I think a principle that works for everybody, but you could potentially better understand how it affects different groups in the economy. And again, it goes to the issue of aggregation and heterogeneity. So, yeah.
Christian Frasser raised the hand. So if you wanna ask your question.
Okay, is that okay?
Yeah.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Okay. Thanks for this fantastic presentation. I want to ask you. I would like to listen more about this discussion you mentioned about the infinite horizon or this. Yes. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, which is a kind of a principle or a key ingredient in any environment where money, you know, displays a positive value. Either, you know, in a overlapping generation model or in a search model.
Yeah.
So, and my sense is like this assumption is quite important because the definition of fiat money in those environments, those models is extremely demanding I mean, the asset is not redeemable, doesn't have an intrinsic value, and also is not supported by any other asset or by any other institution, which, I mean, historically can be very, you know, very hard to find a historical case or motivation for that idea of fiat money, but it's fine. I mean, we are modeling and we're thinking a very crude case. So far, I mean, what I got from your presentation is like the pressure have been on the experimental people, like try to accommodate, you know, the fact that in models would have this assumption and try to show me that, you know, that it works in the lab. But when I have in mind this definition, we have in search model, for example, fiat money, I have to concede that, you know, that definition is extremely, you know, extremely demanding to find, you know, in real facts. So because if I remember well, you can have some, let's say, probably search model, but for sure, overlapping generation model, where you have you don't have an infinite horizon, but still you have some institution like a taxes or any other institution that support the value of money, even if there is a moment where the model, you know, there is no more time. So in that sense, you know, my question is like, there have been some kind of, let's say, collaborative work with theoreticians that are willing to change the environment of the model, you know, to have like a version of fiat money more realistic that, you know, at the same time can help the work of people doing experiments. And this also is related with, you know, an extra idea that just came to my mind. I mean, these models, you know, typically display multiple equilibria, and some of these equilibria money has a positive value, and in those andrasoniclia where the value of money is zero. And it seems to me like, I mean, of course, when you have the value, you have confidence in your money, you don't care so much about the future, you know, you just take it as a given. But in a hyperinflation, of course, you just think so much about the possibility of, you know, if you can have a trading partner in the next day. So it seems to me like this discussion about, you know, if we work with infinite horizon or not is also influenced by the institutional context, you know, about the confidence that people have on the, let's say, the environment and the value of the money. You know? So that is some ideas about
Yeah, I mean, in these models, there are
also, ask you also the last question that came through the chat, which is if there has been any bridge between neuroeconomics and experimental macro. And then I think I'll give you time to answer, you know, these questions, and then we close and we continue next Thursday. I'm gonna say something at the end. So please, Daniela.
Yeah, I mean, basically, I mean, these models also, of course, if you add, you could also add that you use money to pay taxes or other things. I mean, you could do a similar experiment with some kind of form of commodity money, right? Typically, the idea would be that if you take commodity money, it has value, right? If you send commodity money or the price of commodity money to zero, you convert to the equilibrium of fiat money with value, something like that. So there is behind the idea. It's supported by something like that. Regarding like environments where also theoretically, maybe you don't need you do not need an infinite horizon and money could still have value. There are some, there is some papers actually by Kovanok and Derry. So these were theories where basically I think it's finite fiat economy, something like that. Where they basically say that there are other ways, even if the economy has finite horizon, you could still basically introduce some changes in the environment that give value to money. For example, maybe I do not know my position in line, okay? There is an uncertain position. Or there is a way to assign some terminal value. You can condition strategies. So there is gonna be a game at the very end, some coordination game, where the equilibrium that we play at the end might depend on what we did in the past. So for example, if we use money in the past, we coordinate on the good equilibrium. If we not, we go to the bad equilibrium, right? So these are threats that are credible because both are equilibria in the coordination game, right? So overall, I would say, I think that the environment with uncertain position, and actually there is some paper by Doug Davis, Oleg Korenok, Randy Wright, Bruno Sultanom, and Peter Norman, so all these people, kind of three monetary economists and two experimentalists that implements this type of environments in the lab, but the results are not clear. Basically, it looks like the money appears to have value both when it should or it shouldn't. Okay, so even when it's not an equilibrium in the model, it's they use it. But I can discuss with you more. There are some issues, like we're looking now at a different implementation of the model where that's not the case. Okay, that's again going to how you implement a model and what's the closest implementation. But I mean, I would say that if you want to do monetary policy, I mean, at least like I was interested, let's say, in the Friedman rule or inflationary monetary policy, in particular, at least at the beginning, through changes in the money supply. These are good environments because also, unlike the overlapping generation, which, by the way, I like very much as a model, we don't need to rely on, I mean, basically, we have welfare implications because in the overlapping generation, some generation might be hurt by inflation and some might gain. While in that case, we have an unambiguous prediction. And again, as far as I am concerned, really the only reason that I did this stuff of assigning the continuation value, which basically goes around these criticisms that people have, the only way I did it, the only reason I did it is because, again, when I present this in front of monetary economists, at least not all of them, I must say, some people are fine, but some bring up this point, oh, you are not really implementing the model because you cannot implement inflationism. So that's the reason why we did, because with this method, you are really close to the model because you are computing the continuation value. So they would get given the strategy, right? The monetary strategy that depict, if you like, and we give it to them, the discounted value. So they are given the payoff and it's endogenous. Okay, so if they were giving value to money, they get a positive value. If they were not, they would get zero, right? So, but again, the only reason I did it is to address this point, because as far as I'm concerned, typically in experiments, you see an impact, you have these intertemporal incentives. Even in the context of finite repeated game, namely prisoner's dilemma case, you see people cooperating until the very end kicks in, okay? So again, I don't think that, it is difficult in the lab to implement these incentives. And again, I think the quote by the theorist is kind of, I think it's a very nice quote. Basically, this idea that you shouldn't interpret the model literally, right? But both as capturing here, right? If the play, the fact that the situation has a horizon, it's some sense, physical sense, finite or infinite, does not imply that the best of the model as a finite, the best model of the situation as a finite horizon. But anyway, yes, you could think about constructing other environments. I mean, in our case, we constructed, as well as Shyam Sander for overlapping generation, he found a way to give the last period value and so on and so forth. But I mean, you could think also about different environments, and there has been some progress. But again, as of now, the model of Kovanok and the RE wouldn't be applying to more complex, to richer, you could apply to address richer questions. You could apply to study essentiality of money, but not like monetary policy, for example. And then there was another question. What was the other?
If there is any bridge
Between neuroeconomics and experimental macro. Actually, honestly, I do not know. I would expect if something definitely has been done is about patients, right? I would expect like with this hyperbolic discounting versus other. But honestly, I don't know. Let me see if, what kind of links would one see about, I would expect maybe in this part of looking at exponential or hyperbolic discounting, but maybe in the context of asset market, there might be something, but I'm not sure about neuroeconomics, yeah.
Okay, so thanks again, Daniela. It was very, very interesting. And thanks, everybody. I think the discussion was also quite interesting. So I'm inviting again everybody next Thursday at same hour. We will do, you know, some asset market year, create our own bubble and the first official financial crisis.
Let's see. We don't know, right? So we don't know if it's going to happen, if it's going to happen or not. But hopefully the program is going to work because, so I don't know. I guess I should expect around 50, 60 people.
I think at the maximum we were close to 80 person.
Okay.
Something about
that is, it's gonna last probably around 30 to 40 minutes, and then we'll discuss a bit the results and some of the finding in the literature. Yeah.
Okay. That sounds great.
But I'm not gonna pay you real dollars, I'm sorry. But you should act as if.
Okay, so On Thursday, financial market, and then next Monday, next week, we will talk about monetary economics. So thanks again. Thanks, Daniela, and thanks, everybody, and have a good night. Okay?
Thank you very much for attending and for the questions. Okay. Bye.
Right.
Thank you.